Well, Providence Resources and Gulf Keystone are two companies that have plainly seen more favourable times. But through recent new arrangements, they've been given another chance by investors. Well, can retail investors now be more confident in the prospects for these companies? Well, I'm joined now by Malcolm Graham Wood, founding partner of Hydrocarbon Capital and author of Malky's blog. So Malcolm, do you think we're going to see a deal for the Barryroe asset, or does the investment case for Providence Resources now hinge on new drilling in the Atlantic margin?
Yeah, very interesting for this company, who a few months ago were absolutely flat on its back with a lawsuit which they'd lost against Transocean and next to no money, and not having farmed out Barryroe. The company had been trying to tell the marketplace for several years now that it was going to farm out Barryroe, which is its oil field offshore Ireland, but have been unable to do so for various reasons, and litigation doesn't help. But everything has all of a sudden fallen into place for Providence, because having lost the case, they had to raise money. They put together a very credible case for having a raise, and have raised a best part of $70 million a few months ago, which has given them a number of interesting opportunities. Because the irony of it is that people who wouldn't have farmed into Barryroe because the company was in financial difficulties are now looking at it, and I understand that they've got several people looking at Barryroe, and they will farm that out probably sometime next year. Once they've done that, of course, they're in an even stronger position. But the raise of the $70 million has also given them an opportunity to bring one or two of their, as you say, their Atlantic margin prospects into real-time drilling ready. And the one they're looking at the moment, to be honest, I think that they're looking at a thing called torrid, which a long time ago, with the oil prices very high, would have been a very expensive well to drill. But I think that whereas they would have spent probably $200 million on a well there, they're going to spend something like $35 million dollars and drill next June. They've got the opportunity. There's another potential development find below, so another $50 million would take them to the deeper area as well. So the irony is that Providence has changed everything: a raise of money, good quality shareholder list. They'll probably, I know that they're still appealing the transaction case, which now, but they've got the money, they'll probably win, and they've got Barryroe. More people looking at it before, but it mustn't be forgotten that for most people who look at exploration, they'll be looking towards next June, and the drilling of the well on Druid.
Okay, so you've spoken about Barryroe and Druid, but why should we be excited about offshore Ireland generally? How does it compare with the North Sea market?
Well, the interesting thing about the offshore Ireland, the margin, is that a long time ago, many people came in, got interested in it because there were a couple of modest discoveries and people thought it was very good. Then, because it was deemed to be an expensive place to drill, people sort of walked away from it. People like Cosmos, who had exposure there, decided to drill elsewhere. And the people who were left with Irish margin, Atlantic margin plays, could do nothing with them. But in the last year or so, particularly through the Irish licensing round, which completed a few months ago, we suddenly found that all these majors and the big companies were coming back in again, and we talk about Statoil or BP or Eni, Exxon, a whole bunch of them come in, and people, companies like Providence, have found themselves with a really fine piece of acreage and surrounded by the Exxons and the Statoils of this world, who have not only got the decided that it does look interesting, but they've got the wherewithal to start drilling. And So activity in the Atlantic margin is all of a sudden looking much more exciting and will pick up in the next couple of years. So, you know, acreage which had been very much on the back burner is now very much of interest. And, you know, we'll even see, you know, people like Europa Oil and Gas, who've got quite a big portfolio there, and obviously people like Providence, you know, very much dusting off these prospects, which again look interesting, and some of them are drill ready, as it were, because they spent the last 2 or 3 years doing all the back work in the office.
Well, let's go to Gulf Keystone now. Is it a recovery play, or is a punt on the company being the subject of a takeover offer?
Well, no, not really, because I mean the situation with Gulf Keystone has been absolutely critical. They've found themselves with a world class operation in Kurdistan, and Shaikan, which is their world class operation, their field in Kurdistan, has been getting better and better. But because of the war and the payments not coming through, effectively Gulf Keystone just got strangled on payments. And, you know, in the last 2 or 3 years, the Kurdistan regional government was just unable to pay them. So, you know, without investing any more money in their PSC, the production sharing contract, which they've got there, things were looking pretty grim, and to be honest, it's all very well having a world-class asset, but if you aren't spending any money on it, it's always going to get less and less. So Gulf Keystone got in the situation where they were in debt. The debt holders, as is often the case on these occasions, you know, stepped back from the process, and the management had no choice but to effectively wind the all the debt down, and the equity shareholders lost most of their interest. But what happened here was that at the time they did an equity rights issue. Shareholders who had been in it and had seen their money almost entirely wiped out knew that the asset was still there and things were looking a little better in Kurdistan. They were able to say, right, well, we can have a look at this again. I know, you know, people were considering it, throwing good money after bad, but maybe now not. Things are looking a little better here. Equity shareholders will never make as much as they might have owned before, but it is a proper oil field, and if you believe that things are getting a bit better in Iraq and Kurdistan, then you've got to say, right, this is a chance to maybe one last chance to make money out of Gulf Keystone.
So Malcolm, the chief executive, has told investors that the company will be in, quotes, the strongest position it has been in for a number of years once the restructuring has been secured. Do you agree with him?
Absolutely. I mean, they've sorted out the bondholders. They've made an equity raise. The company is getting paid. That's the most important thing. Once it starts getting paid a little bit more, further investment will be able to go back into the company, and I see that the opportunities are potentially not as high as they might have been, but certainly a reasonable return on a very good asset.
Okay, so I'm sensing that you believe that the relaunch of Gulf Keystone might be a success.
I think it will be. The point is that they need money to invest in what is, as I said, a world-class asset. If they can do that and they can keep the balance sheet reasonably favourable and they don't have any problems in being paid by the KRG, this, as I said, is a world-class asset which should pay out world-class returns. And I'm sure in the longer term, the chief executive is right.
Okay, even against the backdrop of the low oil price?
Well, I think that the low oil price is okay. I mean, in the sense that if it went back below $40, they would be in some trouble. But don't forget, you know, the Shaikan oil field is being developed through a number of key production facilities, and providing that the biggest risk is not being paid by the KRG, if the political situation in Iraq and in Kurdistan in particular remains as stable as it has been for the last few months, and they start selling crude oil into the Turkish refiners, then I think that Gulf Keystone looks interesting again.
Okay, so it's been well documented how Gulf Keystone got into this mess. What lessons can the oil juniors learn from that?
Well, I suppose the lessons are, first of all, you've got to make sure you, even if you have got a good quality project and a portfolio of assets, that you're in a country that can make sure it pays. The geopolitical worries of being somewhere like Iraq are extremely difficult. You need shareholders who are prepared to back you and be supportive, you know, even through the difficult times. And you need to make sure that you are not being called for money. You know, you need to be the operator. You need to be the guys who decide when things are happening. Because the worst thing is that if you're in a position where, you know, you don't decide where the next well is drilled or where, you know, the next responsibility comes from, somebody else will do it for you. You know, you need to be in charge of your own profile.
A beautiful précis, Malcolm Graham Wood, founding partner of Hydrocarbon Capital and author of Malky's blog. Thank you very much indeed for joining us today.
My pleasure.